Ernie and Joy Steinman. Today is April 26, 1995, and Dr. Hyatt will be running the video, so we'll be taking your picture also. And this is for the Historic Mineral Achievement Center. And what we'd really like to do, maybe you can tell us about your father, Ernie. We're interested in the migration of those Swiss people that came over here. But, Captain, where did your father came from, or come from, in Switzerland, about what time? Can you relate to that?
Mm-hmm. Dad came, was born in 1895, and he came over in 1914. And he rode the rail up to Argonne. And when he came over with his sister and brother. And first year he worked for his brother Fred on the Five Corner Cheese Factory south of Monroe. And then for a time he worked on a farm over by Argyle. And mother came over in 1916. And she worked for Adam Bloomer here in Monroe. They owned the brewery and the city hotel. And she done housework for the Bloomer family.
That was in the brewery, was known as the Bloomer
Beer. That was the Bloomer Brewery at that Bloomer time, Beer. Yes. Which is Huber now, yes. And then in 1918, they were married, and they made cheese at the Surge Cheese Factory, south of southwest of Blanchardville. And then from there, he moved to the Creambridge factory, which was between Monroe and Browntown. Remember that old garage just sitting out there along the highway?
Oh, yeah.
Sits there by itself. That was a Creambridge.
Oh.
And from there, he went to the Beambridge at Lamont, which is over back near Fayette and Darlington.
Another ridge.
Yeah. And then he went across the field to the Sanderson factory from there. And then to the Blyder Cheese Factory, which is near Argyle, midway between Argyle and Monroe. That's where I was born.
Were all these Swiss factories then?
All Swiss factories. See, at that time they were small, make cheese 6 months out of the year. They were always looking for something better. Then from the Blyder factory, we went to the Berry Cheese Factory, which is down here by Parkville, right across from where Howard Grossman built his house.
And Claro is south of Monroe, right?
That's south of Monroe, yes. And, of course, they raised five children.
Can you
And another thing I want to bring to your attention. The first cheese days here in Monroe, my father and Fred Steinman, they were at the Five Corner Factory. My father worked for Fred. They made cheese down here in Spring Square. History is all gone because, the Fitzgibbons building burnt down, the history went to it. That was the first cheese day. I think it was 1915.
And the Fitzgibbons is where they made the carriages,
rigs. But up above they had that storage, and that's where it had all this history stored in there. And of course, it was burnt down. And of course, father, after buying a berry factory that was right near the Depression, he thought farming was better. So that's when he went farming. And he stayed farming.
Well, how old were you then? Do you remember much of the time spent at the factory?
5 years old with the old one, and dad went farming. Right. I was 5 years old, yeah.
And then you milked the cows.
And of course, in my young boy, she said, I didn't want to farm.
Well, did you ever have to haul milk to the cheese factory?
Well, I did, yes. Yes, I did.
And what transportation did you have?
I had a Model T Ford. A Model T Ford. That was the first car I drove. And I'm looking for one yet to this day.
Well, how many cans of milk were you hauling in that boat?
Well, we hauled 30-gallon milk cans. I can't read right offhand. I can't recall how many pounds of milk we had. Well, we don't flush at that time. 500 pounds is a lot of milk. And then, of course, I decided to go work in the cheese factory. So I went, I got a job with Jake Bissinger, planning an Olson factory, if you know where that's at, between Monticello and Arc on County Truck C. Well, there we took in milk at night and cooled it. And you know, didn't give me much on a Saturday night, did it? The lady, they'd come to the factory with the last one to come probably about 10:30. Then he hadn't washed the cooler yet. And of course, the boss, he'd go upstairs.
You were making cheese 7 days a week now.
That's right, 7 days a week. And the same year, I decided I wanted to get something easier, so I hired out to Albie Nicola on the surge factory. That's where my father, that was up between Blanchardville and, south and west of Blanchardville. My father made cheese there at his first plant.
Albie Nicola.
Yeah, Albie, he just passed away, you know.
He was quite a dancer.
Yes. And a good fellow to work for, yeah. And, of course, while I was there, I have to tell you this. I said, save $200, see, and I wanted to buy a car. So I had enough money to buy a 1936 Ford, pay cash for it, but only about 25,000 miles on it. The year where Milt Johnson comes up with a great big Chrysler Imperial, a 1937. And that's all I could think of. But he won $525 for that, you see. And I only had $200. So I asked Albie, and I said, no. Would you loan me the balance? No, Albie said, listen, you buy that Ford. You've got $200 saved. Now, that's the same thing. He said, I won't help you out. No, I got stubborn. I had somebody co-sign, and I bought that Chrysler. So I got $50 a month, and I was making $28.50 in payments a month. And in the winter, I got $30. That didn't go too far.
Well, maybe Albie had a point there.
Yeah, he had a point. Yes, he did. You know, that was a good lesson. That was a good lesson. In fact, I had to put the car up in blocks. Well, then from there, I went to work for Otto Talman at Puelai Creek, you know, up by Madison, north of Belleville.
Yeah, that's right.
And then my dad moved on a farm with more land the next year, so he needed help, so I went back home. And in the summer, then I washed cheese on three factories. I washed cheese for 10 cents a wheel.
All right, now, what year was this?
This was in 43. 43.
The war was on. The war was on. And this was something new, you know. I've never really heard before that people going out, hiring out washing cheese.
Yeah.
But being the shortage of hired men and help, and the factories were getting bigger. So it was a new trend in the cheese business, or in the cheese factory business, to where people would hire out, just wash cheese on the side, and they got paid so much a wheel.
That's right.
And you didn't have to wash the lids.
Yes, in some cases, yes, we had to
wash. For the 10 cents. Or did you get a penny a lid?
No. 10 cents a wheel plus washing lids. And I washed these for Albert Yeager there on the Wyoming factory. In the old plant. And for John Kernan, on the Pleasant Valley.
Now, where's Pleasant Valley?
That's north of Brown Town, Jordan Center. And at the same time, Jordan Center factory for Kinsley. So I washed those three factories that summer.
And that would be like twice a week?
Twice a week.
A total of how many wheels do you think that it cost?
I spread it out. So you had washed the coal cellar, like one day, and maybe the bottom at the same time. Gosh, I don't know. They were making about five, and Yeager over there was making six.
But how many wheels a day would you approximately wash?
I'd wash
100?
125.
125 a day, about 5 days a week.
Yeah, at night. In the evening, most of the time, of course. if perhaps I didn't have to do anything at home.
And the reason you, like you said, the bottom, that was where the cheese came out of the coal cellar.
Yeah, the bottom in the heating cellar, you see. The top was always easier to wash.
There's a little schmutz on there.
Yeah, schmutz on there, yeah, I agree. Well, then, that fall I hired out to Ernie Ballard at the Decatur Smiths. It was just a brand new building. You know the Decatur, it's over by Broadhead. East of Monroe here. And then I was called in for Army, the Army Army, in 1944. I spent 14 months in the Luzon Islands.
What outfit were you with in Luzon?
I was at the 14th, 12th Quartermaster attached to the City Center Division. And I was discharged in 1946. And came home before I had my discharge, I hired out to Milo Dittmeyer at the Pleasant Valley Rec Factory south of Winslow. And in the meantime, while I was working for him, I had met my wife, Joyce Pale.
Hey, Joyce, where were you from?
I was from Woodford. I was born and raised at Woodford.
Anything else can you add to how you met him?
Well, we met up at Turner Hall.
Yeah, we used to dance.
A lot of romances got started. The dance up
right
there.
Right here at Turner Hall.
And here we are interviewing you right here at Turner Hall.
That's right.
47 years later. Almost 48 years.
That's right.
And we were married then in 1948. And I bought Milo out in 49. We spent 42 years of our lives there in that factory.
Which was called,
we renamed it the Pleasant Valley. It was a rec factory. Later years I bought the building. And we raised five children. And of course, early years I had, my brother worked for me for 8 years. Then by that time I had little fellas coming up, you know. As quick as they can put it.
What kind of cheese did you make then?
Made Swiss.
And what was your top production, you think?
Made eight, and that would be the top. That was the most I made.
That was eight a day.
Eight a day. And I know the least I made during the winter would be three and four. And then later in 1953, I started making rhymes. In the late 60s, then I put in a vat so I could, wouldn't have to make cheese on Sunday. But then we'd have to double up on Monday and Saturday and Mondays. And, which made a lot of work.
Well, there always was a lot of work.
There always was a lot of work. But you know, I enjoyed it.
Did you wash a lot of your own cheese then at this Pleasant Valley factory?
Well, not after I bought on Mike, I had hired help washing cheese. And the first years I didn't have a truck until the early 50s, and I had to furnish the truck and pick up the milk.
Did you ever help down there, Joyce?
Oh, yes, I know.
Well, what was your job there at the ads?
Well, he used to take the cheese out himself over a board, uh-huh. And then I pull the board out when he got the cheese out.
That was when we were operating pretty much with the family. Later years, we operated pretty much with the family.
And you were never tempted to some days to let that board go?
No.
Well, no, not really.
can you explain here what we're talking about here?
What's that?
This board, taking the cheese out, kind of give you a little description.
Well, you know, in order to dip, I did like to dip myself. You lay the board across the kettle, and you lay on it so you don't fall in. And you run through with your berkeley and your dip cloth to take the cheese out.
You slide it underneath the curd, and up there was 300 pounds of...
Well, it probably weighs that right to big. I read it with the
weight.
Weight, yes, with your pulley. Well, she used to, whenever she heard the chain noise start, she'd come running down. She goes, she'd have a polished kettle.
You polish the kettle.
That kept you slim.
And with buckeye powder, I presume? Is that what you use?
Yes.
Buckeye pie? Yes, everyone used Buckeye.
You bet.
I was talking to a lady earlier here the other day, Esther Sackler.
Yeah.
And, you know, over in Switzerland, they were saying, and I never experienced it, but they were saying where they polished the kettles with sand. And the first I ever heard of it was this Esther Sackler down at the Olsen factory, and he said my father, when he was a bachelor, he got married. Took sand, put it together, got in there barefooted, and rubbed around there with the sand. I don't know how they ever got all the sand out of there.
I guess I probably didn't, you know.
Well, they probably didn't go up with the cheese either.
Back then, you know, they probably they used to, back years ago, they used to plant a lot of funny things in China cheese. Throwing it in five pair of boots in it once in a while. Funny thing happened one time when I was taking in milk. One of my patients, John Garner, see when we had all cans, first can I dumped, you're a fish fell in there, fell in the strainer. And of course John said, well, that isn't my fish. You see, he had a spring house where he cooled his milk. You know, he didn't have a milk house, he had a spring house. It was a clean apartment. But that was kind of funny. Well, anyway, we raised five children at the factory when we were there, and my son, Brian, there is a diesel shop here in Judah, and my son Mark is maintenance manager for Elpendale, and he has his own business here. He's staying here.
Ernie, did you make all Swiss then, did you? I think I asked you that before.
I made all Swiss.
And where did you sell it? That's what I was waiting to talk
about. Dorman's bought. Well, when I first started making cheese, I sold to Ohaus in Chicago. And then he went out of business. And then we started with Dorman. Dorman Cheese Company. And I sold some to Pauly. And Triangle, I sold cheese.
Did you ever have any problems with grades or anything with the graders being a little bit of?
Well, you know, it was a kind of, it's kind of, you know, right? You know yourself, it was a big racket, and it still is today. It's just still great. You know, it all eats the same, you know. And I always told them, I said, now, why don't we try to sell a flavor instead of the eyes, the eye formation? Now, that would make sense, right?
Absolutely.
But they don't do that to this day, yet. Yeah.
Would you say that you had a fruitful life? Really had the cheese making that.
Yes.
And you saw a lot of changes, right?
Yes, over the years, seen a lot of changes. When I started, I had a can washing. Some didn't have a can washing back then.
Yeah, that was considered pretty modern if you took the.
And they were a pain, you know. Cans flying all over, you know. If you go to these plants where the Amish share, the Amish plants, you can see, you can still, that's where you got to go to get back to old reality, you know. You go can washer, cans falling down, see, they don't
have,
you know. That's,
Well, I know when I grew up, my first job was wash those cans once a week. I don't know.
Yeah.
I had a can washer.
Can washer.
Because it didn't matter what you did. Yes, wash.
Yes,
the
outside. Yeah. And we have our daughter lives in Madison. She's a nurse. We have two sons in California. One of them is managing Nissan leadership. The other one is trucking.
Well, now, Ernie, were you mostly on percentage? Was it the co-op or did you?
Well, yes. Well, I bought something of later years, you know. It was a co-op. I run as a co-op all the time. After I bought the building, I still run as a co-op. But there were some farmers who wanted, they couldn't wait for their money, you see. As soon as you had to wait for the money, usually 2 months. So I would pay them in advance, you see. And so I was still running it as a co-op.
You know, when you think about it, it's quite a thing, you know, the farmer would have to wait that long because it takes that long for the almost 6 to 8 weeks for that cheese to develop that eye, is that right?
That's right, you'd have to, you know, and of course, it had to be 60 days old, right?
Right.
But sometimes it went in 5 weeks, you know, or, you know, some fast workers, evidently they weren't supposed to come, but, you know, we didn't know what they were doing.
Well, I think that was a state law here in Wisconsin only. I don't know if that was.
No matter, I mean, you're going interstate. Yeah. My cheese would go on interstate. So, it'd be the same difference. So.
Well.
Yeah, I mean, if I had it to do over, I suppose I'd do the same thing. I'm building another factory.
Oh, tell me about this. Almost forgot about that.
Yeah, well, I'm in the process, but you know, it's been kind of slow. We started last fall, we poured some cement. And that's just going to be a novelty thing. I'm going to make cheese for ourselves. There'll be one kettle. It won't be big. Just, you know.
And you're going to do this?
Keep my fingers in the curd, I guess.
Okay, but what I was talking about, you have a miniature.
Oh, yeah. Project. Yeah. Well, it's my son.
Yeah, could you elaborate a little bit on that?
Well, he built it according to the plant that I had, the factory down there that I had in the 50s with the can washer and everything, old stoker boiler, you know. We had the old stoker boiler back then, you know, and got modern, got oil. Back when John L. Lewis went on strike.
They were always striking on
That's when we decided we needed oil. And I can remember when they started with oil, I was buying oil for about 19 cents. Now what do you pay for that?
And the nicest thing about the oil was cleaning those flues.
Yeah, you didn't have to clean them every day.
No.
Yeah. Of course, when I had air, man, oh, they hate to do that. Sometimes, you know, they probably just open the door and shut it again. But I know it the next day.
Well, those old flues and those old cold water boilers, I had every day. That's one of the first jobs I got when I was a young boy, to push that rod through.
And you had to clean them every day. If you were, you know, otherwise you couldn't hold the steam pressure. Yeah, well, you know, back when Dad made cheese, it was open fire.
You remember the hearth then?
Oh, yeah.
Or did you have a fire wing?
Oh, he had a fire wing. I'll show you a picture. I got a picture here. I got to show you. Dad. That was Dad when Dad was on the fire floor. He fritz. This is a picture of him right here. We were down on the fire floor. There's a picture. I'm going to have that. I'm putting a bunch of pictures together and then so we can hang them up in the cheese oven.
Well, we'll get one here for Doc Hine. And maybe he can get this here on the close up to that there.
That dates back to 1915. Dates back to 1915. My father, Ernest, and my uncle Fritz started in the Five Corner Cheese Factory.
Well, isn't that something? Well, I tell you, it's been a wonderful interview. I'm looking forward to seeing you up on the dance floor upstairs.
Oh, yeah?
And we'll have a cup of coffee or a little pot or 7-Up or something and a little visit afterwards.
Okay. And
thank you very much.
Thank you.
I want to hear more about that model cheese factory. Where's that at?
Oh, my son. It's going to be. He's going to.
Excuse me. I'll get this.